We're holding in Mishlei, Perek Bet. We've completed Perek Aleph. Chapter 2, Perek Bet, Shlomo Melech continues to extol, to talk about the benefits of Chochmah, of wisdom. And it's important that he speaks about it in the very beginning of his Sefer, because eventually, especially beginning with Chapter 3, Perek Gimel, he begins to give us advice in many, many areas. But right now he wants to impress upon us the importance of all this chokmah, why it's a good idea for us to pay close attention, the benefits that we will gain from learning, because a lot of people don't seem to be eager to learn, and some have no interest in knowledge. So he gives us a long introduction, which we've covered already in Perek Aleph, and now a little bit more in Perek Bet, about the significance of Chochmah and how it will help us in life. So Perek Bet is in somewhat a continuation of Perek Aleph, in talking about the benefits of Chochmah. Before I begin with the Pesukim, I'm just going to give you a little bit of an overview of what is being discussed in this Perek. He discusses how the Chochmah, if one pursues it, will gain immensely in various areas. One area that he will gain is that it will help him to protect himself from all evil. There are forces of evil out there. There is a lot of evil in the world. And by him following the Chochmah, following the advice of the Chochmah, he will be able to distinguish between right and wrong. Not everything is crystal clear. There is what we call in English some gray areas. But by immersing himself in this Chochmah, by using the Chochmah as his guideline, he will be able to protect himself from this evil. He will be able to protect himself from bad associations, bad friends, bad partnerships, and, believe it or not, even from bad women. They exist too. In other words, he will be able to choose who to befriend and who to stay away from. All of that by learning all that there is to learn here in this Sefer. One who learns Chochmah will be able to have a great influence on others too. You know, parents are sometimes wondering why they don't have that much of an influence on their children. Why the child doesn't emulate the parent? Why isn't he more like he would like him to be? It all depends how much the father has to give. You know, you can only give as much as you have. Unless the child picks it up somewhere else, unless he has a good teacher or good friends, I mean, he's only going to pick up whatever his home gave him. And if the home was very poor in spirituality, you know, then the child will not pick up that much. So one who acquires a lot of Chochmah is able to impart that Chochmah unto others, even though one has to have the talent for that. Not everybody who is knowledgeable knows how to share that knowledge with others, but I'm assuming that one, of course, has the basic skills for that. So one of the benefits of the Chochmah is obviously to teach others, and by teaching others one can have a tremendous influence on others. People have been very impressed by famous orators in history, non-Jews as well. The orators have a tremendous power in their speech to convince, but what they may be saying is false, without any basis. Nevertheless, there is some power in the speech and some power in communication. The more so if one has the Chokhmah of Hashem, the Chokhmah of Torah, it will give him tremendous powerful tools to be able to influence others. One of the ways of influencing others is through books, through printing books, and today through the internet. It is able to get to a lot of people. We're in the information age, and these are tools that we should use to benefit all those who are thirsty, who are in need of this. Unfortunately, these lines of communication are being used for evil, for negative influences, so we have to take advantage. When the first tools came out in the early part of the 20th century, the Chachamim saw clearly that these are tools that can be used for bad or for good. Television is being used for bad, but it's a very powerful tool that if it was channeled properly, you know, a lot of people could gain a great deal from it. Unfortunately, I think the influence of TV has been more detrimental than beneficial to mankind. People are no longer satisfied just to read about the news, they have to see it. You know, and so they're all they're doing is just absorbing all the bad news, all the negativity there is out there. But in reality, the Chochmah could also use these tools that are out there to impress upon others good things. Another idea that will be found in this Perek is that if a person makes an effort to acquire this Chokhmah, he is not alone. He will receive his assistance from heaven. And the Shamayim, they're going to help him. He will not only receive assistance from heaven, but his mind will open up, his heart will open up, and he will receive guidance. Our tradition tells us that HaKadosh Baruch Hu guides us as long as we don't put up a fight, as long as we don't interfere with his plan, as long as we go along with it. So if we show an effort, if we show an interest, then we will be guided. Another benefit of learning all this Chokhmah is by immersing oneself in this Chokhmah, one will also acquire Midot Tovot. And that's something that we will be covering a lot in this lay, something that we briefly discussed called Musar. Shema benim Musar Avicha v'al titosh Torah Timecha. We have Torah, we have Chokhmah, but we have Musar. Musar are the ethics, the good behavior, the good conduct that we are being told to adopt in our life. It's not necessarily a mitzvah mina Torah to be a gentleman. It's logical. And the Torah, of course, demands of an individual to refine his character. And by way of the mitzvot that we received, we are able to acquire those characteristics. There are a lot of individuals who may be observant of Shabbat, of kosher, but they're not gentlemen. They're not nice. And as a result of that, of course, they make a lot of enemies. They don't get along with people. And they're missing a great deal. As one of the pesukim we will see later on, one who's knowledgeable and has no derech eretz, no good midot, is compared to having a golden ring on the snout of a pig. It's a beautiful gold ring, but where is it sitting? It's sitting on the nose of a pig. So it's important that one acquire all this knowledge and apply it and put it to use in his conduct. Otherwise, what good is all this knowledge? Another way of looking at it is the way the rabbis tell us. Imagine somebody being given the keys to a safe. Safe which is indoors, but he was not given the keys to the outside of the house. What good will those keys of the safe do him if he cannot enter the house? One first has to enter the house, then he can use the keys to the safe. The same is true with Chokhmah. One has to have the basic, and that is the derech eretz. And if he does not have the derech eretz, all the Chokhmah is really not useful. So part of the acquisition of this Chokhmah is to impart on us the proper conduct that a Jew should have. So when one looks at him, when one looks at a Jewish individual, at his conduct, at the way he does business, it should be a Kiddush Hashem. It should be a way where one can sanctify Hashem's name. The Midrash says, how do you love Hashem? By making others love Him. By saying, oh, this is what a Jew is all about. This is how he conducts himself. That is something to look up to. So, in the eventuality, one who acquires this Chokhmah, he's given the tools. He will know how to refine his character, but he still has to overcome his Yetzarim, his evil inclinations, whatever they may be, his anger or laziness. But he has the tools. He at least knows, he's aware what his weaknesses are, what he needs to do. He might need perhaps the advice of others who are more knowledgeable than him. He may need to consult with a rabbi, just like people go to psychologists, on what to do about it. And you know, it's not such a good idea to try to figure out the solution to a problem all by yourself by looking at books. It reminds me of a story of an individual who once came to a rabbi to seek a blessing. And the rabbi gets into a conversation with him. So, do you learn Torah? Do you learn Musar? And so forth. And do you have a rabbi that you go with to consult with when you have questions? So he says, Rabbi, I don't consult with anybody. I bought an entire library of books, and that's good enough for me. So the rabbi tells him, you know what you are compared to? You're compared to someone who did not want to ever go to a pharmacy, never wanted to see a doctor, so he bought all the drugs and all the medications that exist and stored them in his house. Will that help him? He does not know how much to use, when to use, what to use. What good is it that you have all the books? There are times that you have to ask, that you have to seek the advice of others. So obviously it's important to know, to become knowledgeable in case, you know, you don't have anybody to ask. And there are many things that you don't need to ask. After all, a human being continues to develop throughout his life. Physically, we stop growing at 18, 19, 20, but spiritually, we continue to grow and to develop. And we develop according to how much we learn and how much we experience in life. A lot of people have tremendous amount of experience. not necessarily in their profession, but they went through a lot. They've seen a lot and they've learned a lot just by experience. And that is why the rabbis tell us in Pirkei Avot, ben hamishim le'etza, when you reach the age of 50, you can give advice to others, because you've gone through so much by 50 that hopefully you've seen. But some people, even at 50 and even at 60, are wrong in their attitude and in what they tell people to do. You know, they have obviously an interest. They're not necessarily seeking the truth. They're not necessarily following the Torah. And as a result of that, even though they're 50 and above, they're not going to necessarily give you the best advice. Following, therefore, this sefer, following the Chokhmah of the Torah, the goal is that one acquire this information to help him and help others. Because if he does so sincerely, as we will see, if he has the right attitude, and that's important, then it will make a lasting impression on him. And as I've mentioned this in the past, it's a guarantee. Anybody who goes through the entire Talmud, guarantee. If he does it with the simple motivation of really wanting to learn, I'm not even talking one who does it Hashem Shamayim, as long as he has normal attitude, he really wants to learn, he wants to find out what the rabbis have to say. If you go through it at least once, you will be immensely impressed. The life stories of the rabbis, their hashkafot, the way they saw life, all their opinions about so many areas in life. When one goes through the over 2,700 pages, it's going to leave a lasting impression. It's definitely going to make a difference. Besides imparting all that knowledge that there is, we're not just talking about dry knowledge. We're talking about becoming like them. And I've always said that one of the best books of Musar, if you really want a good book that will teach you something, read the biography of a tzaddik, of a righteous man, how he lived his life. It's so impressive that you say to yourself, you know, I wish I could be like that. Give it to children. Instead of them reading all the junk that there is out there, this is something constructive, something that will greatly benefit them. There's a lot of good material out there that it could be very, very helpful in molding our personality, in helping us build our spirituality. And that's what Shlomo HaMelech does here with this sefer. Besides giving us advice in how to be careful in the various areas that one can easily fall. So by learning this Chokhmah, one will acquire Midot Tovot, and he will have a very strong defense against Minut, against heresy. And because, unfortunately, human beings are weak, they are very, very weak, and they are defenseless if they have no Chokhmah. Rabbis tell us one of the greatest enemies of man is borut, ignorance. Many, many Jews who are completely ignorant are the first ones to fall prey to all those cults that are out there trying to catch another Jew. Somehow it's a big mitzvah. Somehow it's a big mitzvah for these cults to grab a Jew more than any other individual on this world. More than a Buddhist, more than a Muslim. Get a Jew. You know, and that's because the Jew has the most kedusha, and the tum'ah, the impure forces, want to pursue that which has more holiness in him. So a Jew who's ignorant of his tradition, who does not know anything, is confronted with a major question about faith, about science. What is he going to do? Imagine the big old question of the age of the earth, whereas our tradition says the earth is 5,765 years. And somebody comes over to you and says, yes, but science says it's millions of years old. First of all, science has no proof that it's millions of years old. That's number one. There's no proof. Number two, even the most accurate method that science employs today in dating objects of the past, it's called carbon-14 dating, that is not reliable past 50,000 years. Even the scientists who use that method admit to that. So it's only up to 50,000 years. And that's only based on making certain assumptions. If those assumptions fall apart, then the whole method falls apart. So somebody who is ignorant of the Torah, ignorant of the Midrash, how is he going to deal with this question? Science is very, very powerful. They're very smart, the scientists. We should trust them? No. No, we can't trust them. Not 100%. Unless it's complete fact. much of science is based on theory. And unless it's proven, it's not science. Science is something that can be proven in a laboratory. If it cannot be proven, then it's only a theory. So one who is not prepared, who is not knowledgeable, who does not know how to deal with certain issues, especially the complex ones, you know, he will develop more doubts about his faith. And if it's a cult trying to influence him, if it's not a science teacher, so he's not going to become a believer in evolution, but he will become weaker and weaker in his attachment to his traditions, because all of a sudden he's faced with something that is more convincing than his tradition, so something called science. And that's only whose fault? His fault for not learning. Go open up the book. If you have a question, don't live with the doubt for the rest of your life. A lot of people have doubts as to why the Holocaust occurred. Okay, go and ask a rabbi who knows the answer. Nobody knows the exact answer, because we don't have all the answers to all the questions. But we have some indication as to why terrible things like that happened to the Jewish people throughout history. Why there are tragedies? Why are people suffering? It's all written in the Torah. So one who is well-versed, one who has studied the Torah, and the Gemarot, and the Midrashim, and the Zohar, and the Kabbalah, he's better prepared to answer, to tackle almost any question. That is the value of having the Chokhmah versus not having anything at all. You are exposing yourself to the various dangers that are out there. Rabbis talk about attitudes. There are various people who confront studying Chokhmah from a different angle. The ideal is when one does it lishma. Lilmot Torah lishma means for its real sake. Learning Torah so I can be able to fulfill the mitzvot, so I can teach it over and transmit it to my children. That is the ultimate goal of Chokhmah, of mitzvot. For its real sake, to serve Hashem. Not for any other interest, not so I should be able to get a PhD in Talmudic law. That would be something called Shelo Lishma. You're learning Torah, but not for its real purpose. For some other interest. The rabbis tell us that even though Shelo Lishma is not the real goal, it's okay to begin to learn Torah, any part of Torah, Shelo Lishma, out of curiosity, just to become knowledgeable, just to be able to compete in some tests on Navi, like they have in many schools. You know, in Israel at least they have competitions, and who knows all the stories better. That's all Shelo Lishma, but the rabbis say it's okay to begin, because it's at least a beginning. Get started. You get started Shelo Lishma, mitoch Shelo Lishma yavo Lishma. If you do something, even though it's not for its real sake, it's for some other interest that you have, but get started, because if you get started, eventually yavo lasot lishma, eventually he will do it, he will learn it for its real reason. So it's a good idea just to get started, for whatever reason. So Mishlei, in the beginning of Perek Bet, in discussing the correct attitude that one has to have, and the benefits that one will gain from learning this Chokhmah, he uses the word im, bini, my son. Im tikach amarai, umitzvotai titzpon itach. If you will receive my words and treasure my commandments. He begins with if. There are several times that he uses im. Ki im labina, im tevakshena, as we will soon see. And in the end he responds to all those ims, if. As tavin yirat Hashem vedat Elohim timtza. He begins with if, because it's important to have the right attitude. In other words, if you have the right attitude in approaching all this Chokhmah and all that I'm about to say, that is when you will gain what there is to gain. Important, the attitude that you have. And what's the attitude? So he begins to say as follows. He calls it Beni. He begins with the word my son. So the Midrash says, why does Shlomo HaMelech begin this perek with my son? Because you will be called my son if you treasure this learning, this wisdom, as much as you would treasure precious stones and pearls. Now the Midrash says, Beni, you will be called my son. It was Hashem is saying so, that I will call you and I will treat you as my son if you treat this as something precious to you. So point number one is, the attitude is, treat this not like any other wisdom. This is not zoology. This is not ecology. This is not business economics or business administration, whatever. This is just not another course in college. This is something to be treasured as much as you would treasure a pearl or precious stones. I will call you my son, which is a term of endearment, because you endear the Torah. If you have this attitude, then I will treat you so as well. Imtikach amarai. Imtikach amarai means, in English, if you will receive my words. What does that mean? The attitude needs to be, this is the words of Hashem. Even though Shlomo HaMelech is saying this, our tradition is that everything that is written in the Gemara, everything that was written in the Nevi'im, Uktuvim, and especially the Torah, is really Beruach HaKodesh. The Torah is all words of Hashem, it was dictated to Moshe. But even everything else that came after that, until the Mishnayot, the Gemarot, it was all written Beruach HaKodesh. So one's attitude is, this is, or one's attitude should be, this is Nashamayim, this is the words of Hashem. And why is that important? Because how did the reform movement move away? Because at some point they said, this was written by a human being. This was written by a committee. I just checked today on the internet. I was looking up what we just read in Parashat Shemini. Parashat Shemini, we read that there are three animals in the world that have one of the two signs of being kosher. Right? In order for an animal to be kosher, it has to have split hoofs and chew its cud. And the Torah says there are three that chew their cud but don't have split hoofs. The camel, the hyrax, and the hare. Some say it's a rock badger, a connie, regardless. Now, the camel we know is ruminant. Ruminant means that it chews its cud. But nobody has yet seen that the connie, the rock badger, the hyrax, that class, that animal, those animals, or the hare, H-A-R-E, like the rabbit, chew their cud. So there was a question on the internet about why the Torah said these two and we don't see it. There are various opinions as to how it is that they do chew their cud. But one guy actually got up there on this internet forum and says, well, the Torah was written by human beings, so human beings make mistakes. That was his attitude. That was his attitude, you know. Right? He's obviously not an observant Jew, right? But there is a reason of why, or there is an explanation, I should say, on how they chew their cud. One explanation given is that they defecate the food as little capsules, then they go ahead and eat it again. So they don't have the ability to fully digest their food at once. So the same thing that happens with real true ruminants, that they have to bring it back up from their stomach and re-chew it again. And by the way, the reason for that is because they don't have the upper teeth in the upper jawbone. They only have the lower. They don't have incisors. Right? And they can't chew it well. They can't break it down well. They can chew it somewhat, but they can't break it down well. So the stomach has to add some of the acids and chemicals. It brings it back up and then they chew it again. And that's why they're vegetarian. And these other, the connie rock badger, perhaps have another way of doing it. They do it through their back, not through their front. Maybe that's the explanation of how they do it. Either way, we don't fully understand. But if the Torah said so, then it must be true. So it depends on your attitude. So Mishneh tells us here, Imtikach Amarai. Amarai, remember that these are words of Hashem. This is their attitude should be, you're not just learning anything. You're learning the words, you're hearing the words of Hashem. And then he says the words, Imtikach. Tikach means to acquire. To acquire means even if it costs you money. If it's important to you, you have to be prepared to pay for it. Even though the Torah should be given for free, those who teach it should teach for free, if possible. Those who want to acquire it have to be prepared to spend money. There's a famous story with Hillel, who barely had any money. And he didn't have one day money to enter the Shiva. They used to charge a quarter or whatever it was. So he went up to the roof, right, to hear the Torah all the way from the attic, from the top of the roof. And he was snowed in. And somehow they noticed that there was a shadow of a human being covering the skylight. And that's where they found him. That is how dedicated he was. He didn't have the money to enter. And he went up there to hear from the roof in the cold. One has to be prepared to spend money. That's the important attitude. It's precious. It's valuable. People spend lots of money to take courses of all kinds. The more so the Torah. So, imtikach, be prepared to spend, to acquire it. And this is an important point for parents when they're thinking and rethinking where to send their kids to school. Jewish education has always been a priority for Jews. Women were known to give up their jewelry to sell it in order to be able to afford Jewish education. They gave up everything. They knew that this meant their survival of their children as Jews. They couldn't even dream of sending them to a public school. And today, unfortunately, a lot of people take it for granted that it's okay. We'll, of course, give the child some Hebrew classes, tutoring once a week. Their BMW is more important to them, or their Mercedes-Benz, than their child's education. It's not that they don't have any money. We do. There is a fund. We do have a fund here for those who really have a hard time or struggling to help get their child out of public school into a Jewish school. It's very important. You're saving. It's like Pidyon Shvuim. It's like saving somebody who's been kidnapped. Big mitzvah. The public school is kidnapping our children, and today's public schools exposes them to crime, violence, drugs, and other things that I'd rather not even mention. So Jewish education needs to be acquired. One should make it a priority, even if it means spending a lot of money on it. It was always something that meant a lot to our parents. They were always willing to give everything they owned in order for the child to receive a Jewish education. Another reason why Shlomo HaMelech begins with the word Im, Im Tikach Amarai, as we say in Hebrew, Kol HaAtchalot Kashot, all beginnings are difficult. Is that the way to say it in English? All beginnings are difficult? Even though it's true that all the beginnings are difficult, and even to learn may not be easy, nevertheless, if you begin, as I mentioned earlier, you will receive assistance from heaven. What you need to do as a first step, umitzvotai titzpon itach, in other words, if you treasure the mitzvot, which we mentioned earlier, guard them with you, leakshiv lachochma uznecha, be prepared to listen. One of the first steps to learn, to acquire chokmah, which many people have a hard time, believe it or not, is they don't have the ability to listen. They just don't want to listen to what others have to say. It's either an ego problem, or they simply do not trust the other individual. One has to be prepared to listen. When you're arguing with someone, you also have to give him a chance, the other person, listen to him well. Perhaps he agrees with you. A lot of people argue, yell at each other, and in the end they're in agreement, full agreement. Don't be combative. You know, listen. Be patient. So the first step, other than the right attitude, obviously, is Lakshiv, Lachokhma Oznecha. Pay attention. As he says it over here in the English translation, incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding. Lakshiv Lachokhma Oznecha Tateli Becha Latvuna. You have to be willing to hear what others have to say, even though it may be completely against what you believed all along. A lot of Jews who came out of Russia, who were brainwashed for 50 years that there's no God, it's for them it's very difficult. All of a sudden they're told that you've lived 50 years in error. You're completely wrong. That's very difficult to accept. You know, and obviously some don't even want to hear the proof that you have. It's just too much for them. Unless they're honest, unless they're seeking the truth, then they will sit down and experience a whole seminar. In Baruch Hashem, you know, there are seminars today all over the world that prove logically, scientifically, and otherwise from the Torah, that the Torah is min hashamayim. It is from heaven. It was not made up by a committee, and definitely not by Moshe Rabbeinu. It just cannot be. So one has to be prepared to listen, to pay close attention. Rabbis learn from this, from these words, Lakshiv lachokhma uznecha, tateli becha latevuna, that there's two very important steps in acquiring learning. A lot of boys, when they start learning Gemara, they feel discouraged. Gemara is difficult. Kabbalah is also difficult. There are certain things in the Torah that are easier. Halachot are not so difficult, depending which halachot. Chumash is definitely more fun and easy. Stories. Gemara is much more difficult, much more challenging. To follow the discussions, to follow the many proofs, just to follow the whole conversation that's going on in the Gemara. So the rabbis tell us from this pasuk, and they mention it in the Gemara, Leolam ligris inish, but Gemara is don't spend too much time trying to figure out everything. Don't go too deep. Ligris, read it. Read it, become familiar with the words, become familiar with the style, and become knowledgeable with what's going on in the Torah, in the Gemara. And later on, after you've done it once, the second time around, Lisbel, then go in more in depth. Then you can go into all the pilpulim, all the various discussions that the commentaries mention at a later stage. Leakshiv lachokma uznecha. At first, the first stage should be the simple, easy. The first step should be Leakshiv lachokma, to listen, to go the simple way, the easy way, and then tate libecha latvuna. Tvuna means understanding, a deeper understanding. And this is very, very important, because if you go too deep the first time, you lose interest. You're discouraged. It's just too difficult for me. And it is very difficult. Not everybody has the patience, the mind, or the interest to follow a tough piece of Gemara. There are some easy Gemarot. So the first time around, go through it the easy way. Read the stories. Don't go too much in depth. You will like it. And eventually, the second or third time around, go more in depth. Next pasuk. Ki im labina tikra latevuna titen kolecha. You cry after knowledge and lift up your voice for understanding. What does he mean over here by crying out for knowledge? So Rabbeinu Yonah says that many times what needs to be done in order to acquire a better understanding of Torah is simply to cry out to Hashem, to ask Him for mercy. Help me out! I can't understand the learning. In order to acquire learning, one not only has to have the positive attitude, as we said, to remember that these are words of Hashem, to be prepared to purchase for money, to do it progressively, and if it's still difficult, to cry out to Hashem. If one cries out to Hashem, as I said earlier, he will receive assistance from heaven. That's what he says, cry out, call out for it. Show that you have an interest in it. How much of an interest? You have to be prepared to seek her like you seek silver, money, and search for her as for hidden treasures. What is he talking about? I'm sure most of you know someone out there who has very expensive furniture at his home. Spend a lot of money buying the most beautiful imported furniture, or spends a lot of money on his car or on his home. And a lot of effort went into buying, a lot of effort and money. Shlomo Melech says, listen, you really want to acquire Chochmah, you have to be prepared to spend as much time, effort and money as you did on other things. Just like you never tire of pursuing money, because money to you is very important, right? For many people, money is a goal. It's not just a means, it's a real goal. They want to be rich. They want to acquire as much as possible. Right? And they don't tire. They just go after every opportunity that presents itself. Just like you don't tire and you pursue this money endlessly. The same thing with Chochmah. Tevakshena kakasev. Pursue this as you would pursue money. How many people do that? You know, according to the Kabbalah, if one spends a lot more money on himself and does not spend as much on charity, there's a big accusation against him. If he builds himself a mansion with 17 bedrooms and 12 bathrooms, plus a wine cellar, and plus a butler's hut, is that what they call it? A butler's hut?
Tennis court.
A tennis court. There's a jacuzzi and swimming pool. If he has the money, that's fine. He can allow himself. There's nothing wrong with that. Hashem blessed him with money. He has a berakha. Enjoy it. However, spend as much on tzedakah. Be as kind with others as you are with yourself. Then there's no problem. But Shamayim, they have a big problem if an individual is not balanced. He spends all this money on himself and nothing on tzedakah. After all, Hashem says, why did I give you more money than your neighbor? I entrusted you with this money. If one has more money than his neighbor, it's because Hashem entrusted to him, and that may be his challenge in life. That may be his entire mission. How are you going to use that money effectively? People have money for different reasons. It could be an inheritance, it could be a beracha blessing, it could be their mazal. Regardless of what the source of their money is, it's still a challenge. What are you going to do with it? So, if you have a lot, you want to use it on your own, for your own needs, fine, but be careful to be even, to be balanced in using it for other good things as well. And that's the idea over here too. We spend a lot of time and effort acquiring a profession. We spend years in college learning how to become a lawyer or a doctor. You know, spend as much time and show as much interest in acquiring Chochmah. And in the same way we pursue money, how do we pursue money? Little by little. We don't get rich overnight. You don't get millions of dollars just like that. It happens slowly but surely. You start to accumulate. Unless you're a big spender, hopefully you'll end up saving some money. Some people don't know how to save. That's another problem. We'll talk about that another time. They're always spending. They can't keep track of all their expenses. And they don't save for a rainy day. The right way, the normal way, is that a person
accumulates, little by little he saves up money. The same is true with the Chokhmah. The Chokhmah, one cannot become a big Chacham overnight. He has to be prepared to do it slowly, step by step, day by day. As they say in English, small change makes big change. Right? A little bit at a time. The same is true with Chokhmah. You learn one Mishnah a day. You learn a little bit of you say a little bit of Tehillim every day. And before you know it, you have completed the entire book of Tehillim. Before you know it, you have completed the entire Chumash, all the Mishnayot. And people who just finished the Shas recently have realized what it means to be consistent and learning every day for a little over 7 years. You can complete the entire Talmud Bavli. And that's an incredible accomplishment. Hundreds of years ago, very few people were able to achieve that. Not everybody had the consistency or the interest or the ability to just sit down every night and study. Today, Baruch Hashem, it has become a commitment for thousands of Jews. And it's a tremendous accomplishment. And anybody can do it. If you cannot do it on your own, there are CDs and tapes, and you can do it, you can have a class on the phone. Somebody in virtual time and virtual memory out there is giving you a class. So there's no excuses. You can pick it up anywhere. And in the same way we show an interest in all these other shtuyot, all these vanities in the world, we can demonstrate some interest and spend some time with what is our chokhmah, our Torah. So the chokhmah, just like money, needs to be accumulated a little bit at a time. We cannot possibly get all of that at once. It's too much. Another idea behind comparing this to money, comparing this to the pursuit of money, is some people, when they pursue money, they're willing to forgo all the luxuries. There have been many, many stories of businessmen who have had to stay and were willing to stay in the cheapest hotels possible, because that was the only one around, in somewhere in China, living together with the beggars. And they were asked, how are you able to do that? You're used to five-star hotels. You're used to breakfast on time. You're used to all the comforts. How can you do this? He says, I don't pay attention to all this when I know I'm about to make a lot of money. When I know when I'm about to make a big deal, right? I'm willing to forgo everything. I'm willing not to pay attention to all the luxuries, because all of this is temporary. But I'm going to make, I have a tremendous large deal that I'm going to make over here. So in the pursuit of money, people are willing to forgo luxuries. The same is true. If one wants to acquire Chokhmah, he has to be prepared to forgo all the luxuries. The way that one acquires the Torah, the Chokhmah, the rabbis tell us, is by lack of sleep, by willing to sleep on the floor, by willing to eat bread and water. In other words, just the minimum. If he does so, he will be able to acquire the Torah. If one wants to smoke a cigar, laying down on a lazy chair, is that the way they call those chairs? Lazy chairs? Smoking a cigar or chewing gum and having a book in front of him. First of all, he's probably going to fall asleep in the middle. And number two, he's not going to really acquire all this chokhmah, because the chokhmah, to properly acquire chokhmah, you have to be challenged. You have to really immerse yourself. You can't be distracted. And that's why the big chachamim, all the great chachamim, the way they did it, it was through tireless effort, sleepless nights, and constant commitment. And that is how, little by little, they grew to become the great Chachamim of our times. So one has to be prepared to forgo luxuries if he really wants to acquire the Chokhmah. What will happen after one demonstrates the right attitude and follows all the directions here? In the end, as tavin yirat Adonai v'da'at Elohim timsa. In the end, that's what will be. You shall understand. You will understand the Yirah of Hashem and find the knowledge of Hashem. In other words, the end result will be that one will become more God-fearing. As I said earlier with the example of the Gemara, that if one learns Gemara, even though he doesn't understand it completely, even though he does not go too deeply into it, but in the end, after learning all that there is to learn, something will remain with him. It will affect him. He will be impressed. So in the end, he has the right attitude. He's been committing himself to it. He will be transformed. Many times, women who've had abusive husbands or just simply were having a hard time getting along when they were secular, not observant Jews, they found that their life completely changed. the intimate life, the relationship of husband and wife, as soon as they became more observant, more religious. And why is that? Because the husband began learning Torah. As soon as the man began learning Torah, she could not recognize the man. And by the way, if the man wants to become stronger and the woman does not want to follow, that's okay, continue living together. And eventually, when the woman sees what her husband has become, how he has transformed for the better, she will maybe go along with it, because she will see the great benefit that this has brought to the entire home, to the entire household. So in the end, when one begins to learn this chokhmah, when one begins to learn the Torah, fulfilling the mitzvot, he will be transformed. Yirat Shamayim will penetrate him. What else besides Yirat Shamayim? V'da'at Elokim Timtza. Da'at Elokim Timtza, Shlomo HaMelech is reminding us, you know what you're going to acquire after all your efforts and hard labor? You will acquire Da'at Elokim. This is the knowledge of Hashem. This is not just any knowledge. You will become knowledgeable with the chokhmah of the Torah. It's therefore worth your effort and your time. This is not just any chokhmah. Okay, we go on to Pasuk Vav. Ki Adonai yiten chokhmah mipiv da'at utfuna. Hashem gives wisdom, from His mouth comes knowledge and understanding. That's a very interesting point. Shlomo HaMelech reminds us that even though we make all the effort, we must remember that chokhmah, knowledge, is really a gift from Hashem. Hashem gives this gift to those who are serious about it. It doesn't come by itself. One may try and try and try. If Hashem does not help him out, he will not be able to acquire it. So remember, Shlomo HaMelech says, that Hashem yiten chokhmah. It's important that you keep this in mind. So the rabbis therefore ask the following question. Ma yaseh adam b'yechkam? What should a person do if he wants to become intelligent? What's one of the things that he should do? So they tell us that it would be a good idea for an individual that he should increase his sitting down in the classes of Torah, spend more time in classes, and minimize his business. In other words, instead of spending 8 hours a day in business and only 1 hour in learning, what should a person do and increase his knowledge? Is decrease the time he spends at his business and increase the amount he spends in learning. That's the simple explanation that the rabbi give us, that they tell us that one, if he does this, he will increase his understanding. So the rabbis continue on and say, well, wait a minute, a lot of people have tried this before and they were not successful. They did not become a lot more knowledgeable. They had a hard time with Torah, they struggled, and they did not become chachamim. So the rabbi's conclusion is, yes, and the reason for that is because ultimately in the end we need to ask for rachamim. We need to ask for mercy from the one who gives the chokhmah, that he should open up our hearts and give it to us. And this is what has happened to many individuals who did not realize that the potential that they have. There's sometimes a hidden potential that human beings are not aware of in them. And if they don't try it, then they may never be aware of it. And I like to tell the famous story of the Netziv. Netziv, who wrote many important compositions on Torah. When he was a young teenager, he was struggling in school. He wasn't doing well in his studies. One night, his rabbi, his teacher, appeared at his home and had a talk with his parents. The parents thought that he was already asleep, so they talked very openly with the rabbi, with the teacher. And the rabbi tells him, listen, your son is cute, he's nice, he's a good boy, but chaval alav, it's a shame. Why should he spend all this time in school? Let him learn a trade. He's not doing well in his studies. At least let him learn a trade. You know, in the olden days, how did they learn a trade? They didn't go to trade school. A carpenter went to a carpenter and became an apprentice, right? A shoemaker went to another shoemaker. A butcher went to a butcher, right? In other words, the students who wanted to learn the trade. Let him learn a trade. And the parents appeared to agree that the rabbi made sense. He's not doing well in his studies. And that's how they left. And that is what they agreed on. As soon as the rabbi left, the boy ran crying to his parents, I don't want to become a carpenter. Please give me a chance. All that I want is to learn and to learn and to learn. I want to become a Talmid Chacham. Please give me a chance. And their parents tried to argue with him, but he cried to them, please give me a chance. He said, okay, we're going to give you a chance. But remember, if it does not work out, we're going to take you to the carpenter. He goes back to his room and he begins to cry out to Hashem and to pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu that that's all he wants, that is all his desire and interest in life is to learn the Torah of Hashem. Please help me. I just, you know, he had a block. And the story goes on that from that day on, all of a sudden, his mind opened up. He began to grasp what was difficult for him in the past, and he excelled in his studies. So much so that eventually he turned out to be the great Netziv, a tremendous big rabbi, big Chacham. And he wrote in the Hakdama, in the introduction of one of his famous books, as follows. It says, imagine me not having cried out to Hashem, not having pursued my studies, coming up to the Shemaim after my passing. And after I come upstairs, the angels would come to me and show me a book. And I would ask him, whose book is this? And they would tell me, this is your book. And I would tell them, I don't remember that I wrote a book. And you know what they would tell me? This is the book that you could have written. You had the potential, but you were lazy, you didn't try hard enough. You could have done this. So I thank Hashem, he writes in his introduction, for not having given up, but having cried out and begged Hashem to help. And of course, the end result was that Hashem did assist him. And he not only succeeded, but he became a tremendous big Chacham. Many people, many children have potential. We don't realize it. One should not be discouraged if something is hard. Call out to Hashem. He'll be more than eager to help out. We see from the Torah that Hashem gives Chochmah from the story of Bezalel, the building of the Mishkan. Hashem chooses certain individuals to erect the Mishkan, which required a lot of detail, a lot of talent. Bezalel was given the Chochmah. Why was Bezalel chosen? If you pay attention there, the term Chochmat Lev is used, wisdom of the heart. And what that means is, one of the ideas behind wisdom of the heart means that you had to have a heart to begin with. You had to have an interest, a burning desire to do this for Hashem in order for Hashem to supply you with the Chokhmah. Hashem does not just give Chokhmah to anybody, He gives Chokhmah to those who want to use this Chokhmah for good things. They said, they expressed their desire, Bezalel and his friends. This is what they want to do, they want to contribute. In building the Mishkan, Hashem says, they are sincere, they want to do this very, very much, I will give them the Chokhmah. And there was a lot of Chokhmah required to build something as complex as the Mishkan. Who was given this Chokhmah? Those who deserve it. Those who were going to use it for the right things. Ki Hashem yiten Chokhmah, mipiv da'at u'tvuna. Another idea behind this pasuk that everything is min Hashem, is that even though one can become very intelligent and acquire a lot of knowledge by studying, all that will do to him is give him knowledge and information. He will not necessarily be able to make the right decisions. When it comes to something called Psak Halakha means that there are rabbis that sometimes have to make a decision. Is this chicken a kosher chicken or not? Based on some problem that arose. You need to have a lot of Yeda, you need to have a lot of understanding and a lot of knowledge from the Gemara, from the Shulchan Aruch. But nevertheless, that may not be enough. You mean experience, and that may not be enough. You need something called Siyata Dishmaya. You need Hashem's help. When two people come to you, Reuven and Shimon, who's right? How are you supposed to know? They both seem to be honest. They're coming to court. You have to decide. Remember the story of Shlomo HaMelech with the two women? It's my child. No, it's my child. Well, we're going to cut it up in half. Right? He had to come up with a creative idea of how to determine who the real mother is. Where does that creativity come from? From Hashem. That's called Siyata Deshmaya. It's not enough to become knowledgeable. When it comes to making important decisions that affect the entire Jewish nation or affect an important area of Halakha, one needs Siyata Deshmaya. One needs a lot of assistance from Hashemayim. Another idea that is expressed over here is Ki Hashem Yiten Chokhmah Mipiv Da'at U'Tvunah, is that there are a lot of individuals who have photographic memories, who are very knowledgeable. They remember everything. Where does that come from? That comes from Hashem through a vehicle called Mazal. Geniuses, we call them geniuses. It comes from Hashem by the vehicle called Mazal. They were born at a certain time, and as a result of that, they have this ability called photographic memory. There are some people who use their photographic memory to memorize the entire yellow pages. Ridiculous, right? Or the white pages, all the telephones. There are some great Chachamim who, because of their photographic memory, they remember every single word in the entire Talmud. Most people are not capable of that, even if you went through it 1,000 times. Some people have a hard time remembering Ashleyesh Revetecha, which they say every day, right? To remember everything by heart.
Say Ashmi three times.
And they say three times a day, right? So it's not easy to remember. And some people are gifted. That gift is min hashamayim. That gift comes by way of the mazal. So all of that chokhmah is min Hashem. However, yirat Hashem, which is the ultimate goal of all of this chokhmah, that is up to the individual. That is in the hand of the individual. That is what the Navi says. The Prophet says, and we read it not too long ago in the Haftara, Al yithalel chacham bechokhmato, v'al yithalel ashir be'oshro. No intelligent man should be proud of himself, of his great knowledge and wisdom. No wealthy man should be proud of his wealth. Kim be'askel v'yadoa oti. One can be proud that he knows me. In other words, that he's God-fearing. Because Chochmah in Osher, as Kohelet, which is another book written by Shlomo HaMelech, wealth and knowledge, or the gift of knowledge, not the knowledge itself, which he had to work for, the talent, the skills, that comes min Namazar min HaShamayim. That's all a gift. It's a matanah min Hashem. And therefore, no one should be impressed by any record in the Guinness Book World of Records. Because all of that is a talent that one is born with or developed very, very much. And that's part of his mazal. What can one take credit for? What is something for us to look up to and to admire? Nothing in the Guinness Book or Hall of Records. Only Yirat Hashem. Ki hakol bidei shamayim, chus mirat shamayim. Everything that we just spoke about, the chokhmah, not the knowledge itself, because that you have to acquire on your own, but the skills to be able to memorize and to know so much is a gift. In the end, this is a matanah min Hashem. Yirat Shamayim does not come from upstairs. That's something that we develop and acquire on our own. So what one needs to ultimately work and acquire on his own is Yirat Shamayim. The Chokhmah is a tool to help him get there. But the Chokhmah is also a gift. How much Chokhmah, how easy will that Chokhmah be acquired for him? That's min Hashamayim. Yirat Hashem, how much of a God-fearing Jew one becomes during his life, it all depends completely on up to him. Nobody will influence him. Nobody will tell him how much to become. It's nothing to do with his mazal. It's completely up to his own free will. He makes a decision of if he wants to put on tefillin tomorrow. He makes a decision if he wants to be righteous or wicked. The whole area called Yirat Hashem, which means fulfillment or lack of fulfillment of mitzvot, it's up to the individual. We're not robots. Chokhmah, wealth, what kind of children you will have, who you will marry, we don't make those decisions. It's part of our mazal. Yirat Hashem, if we acquire or we do not, halil acquire Yirat Hashem, that is completely our decision. Last pasuk here, he says, "Yitzpon la'yesharim tushiya, magen le'olchei tom." He lays up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a shield for those who walk uprightly. Those who follow the Torah, those who observe the mitzvot, those who are eager to learn, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will also reveal to them the secrets. Tushiya means the strength or that which is hidden, the essence of the Torah, to those who are sincere. They will not only learn, they will not only acquire knowledge, they will also be privy to the secrets of the Torah. The Chazon Ish was once approached by an individual who himself or his wife had to go through brain surgery. Chazon Ish is a rabbi, not a doctor. And he took out a piece of paper and drew, tell the doctor to cut from this side, not from that side. And he showed him a whole diagram of how to perform brain surgery. Rabbi, did you go to college? Are you a doctor? He says, no, I learned everything from the Torah. Those who are true chachamim, who are God-fearing, who are sincere, who are eager to learn the chokhmah, they will be privy to all the secrets. They will be able to get from the Torah all that there is to know in this world, even something like medicine. Incredible. Magen le'olchei tom. The Torah is a shield to those who walk in its footpaths. The Torah will protect us that we should not stumble. Last week we spoke about all those that Hashem allows to stumble. You didn't listen to me? I'll allow you to stumble. You want to learn the hard way? You want to follow your own mind? Fine. I'll allow you to stumble. Hashem will not allow those who follow the Torah to stumble. They will be protected. Linsor orchot mishpat v'derech hasedav yishmor. He keeps the paths of judgment and preserves the way of his pious ones. And what that means is that the ultimate tachlit of the Torah and all this chokhmah is that we should preserve the mishpatim, that there should be justice, that there should be tzedek. And this is meant a lot for the rabbis and for the judges, that they should not be swayed, that they should not be bribed, because they have to preserve the mishpat. And if they do so, derech, the derech chasidav yishmor, those who are careful to preserve the mishpatim, then they will be offered protection from the shamayim. Nobody will be able to harm them. Be strong, don't be afraid, and stay upright. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu will protect you. As tavin, tzedek u'mishpat u'misharim kol ma'agal tov. Then you should understand righteousness and judgment and equity, every good path. And what that means is that when one acquires knowledge and is upright and righteous and never sways and is always trying to do what is right, then HaKadosh Baruch Hu will help him, that he will have a good understanding in how to deliver justice, how to make peace amongst people in tough and difficult cases, and kol ma'agal tov, including in very creative ways. HaKadosh Baruch Hu will give these individuals who are trying to uphold the Torah the ideas. Sometimes you need creative ideas, and all of that creativity will be given to them by Hashem. In addition to the creativity and to the assistance that one receives from Hashem, kol ma'agal tov is something else. Kol ma'agal tov means every other possible path. The commentators explain that when you're giving musar, when you're rebuking someone, don't go to him directly. Why didn't you do this? Or why did you do this? Go indirect. Begin talking about something else and indirectly try to get to that point. Sometimes that is more effective. Kol ma'agal tov means that sometimes we have to pursue all possibilities to be able to communicate, to be able to teach, to be able to impress upon someone. Kol ma'agal, any possible way, even if it's indirect. Hashem helps those who preserve the Torah and those who want to follow the Mishpat, that they will be granted, they will be given all these ideas on how to bring peace amongst people, how to make people happy, which is very difficult. To make two sides that are warring happy, kol ma'agal tov, Hashem will give us the knowledge on how to arrive at that. Ki tavo chokhmah belibecha v'dat l'nafshecha yin'am. We started off saying how all beginnings are difficult. In the beginning it's difficult, but in the end it will be sweet. It will be so sweet that b'ezrat Hashem, you will want more and more.